Let's go big picture here and lay out the scene, because we have a stock market that is supported by stimulus galore. There's more likely to come. The Federal Reserve, of course, has put a floor under the credit market with its corporate bond purchases. So any company, it seems like, can raise funding. There's a new wave of retail investors plowing into equities. Their motto is stocks only go up, and they haven't really been proven wrong. What kind of environment does that create for short sellers like yourself?
Well, first of all, thanks, Bloomberg, and thanks, Scarlet, for having me. It's great to be here. Well, obviously, it's an environment that has gotten very, very speculative before the COVID sell-off. We were telling clients that beginning in November, right on through February, the market had taken a really speculative leg up, the likes of which we hadn't seen since, dare I say, late 99, first couple of months of 2000. And what made a difference was it appeared for the first time in this 10-year bull market that retail investors began speculating more aggressively in individual names. And people have pointed to the Robin Hood effect and zero commissions. And I know there's a debate about that, but it was unquestionable in our minds and in what we were seeing that the speculative fever kicked up a few notches in the fourth quarter of 2019, first couple months of 2020. The COVID sell-off in March really punctured that for all of about 3 weeks. And it's come back with a vengeance in many cases. And in many cases, stocks are trading meaningfully above where they were in January, February in our little corner of the world. So I think that the massive central bank liquidity injections have certainly emboldened investors to feel that the Fed has their back, if you will.
I like that word, that term, emboldened investors. And just to be clear, Kynikos identify short opportunities, but also long.
I'm losing you.
You were saying, Jim? Sorry.
Could you repeat the question? I lost your audio.
Okay, sorry. I was just getting to Wirecard. It was a long build up to Wirecard here, but this is a former European tech star, but now feels like it's a national embarrassment for Germany because a quarter of its balance sheet has gone missing, $2.1 billion unaccounted for. Is there a corporate fraud going on here, or is this something more mundane, like an overleveraged balance sheet, a business model that's flawed?
Well, we think the evidence has been piling up. This was our largest position in our global short accounts and global hedged accounts. And we think the evidence was almost irrefutable by late last year that something was very wrong here. And management statements about the delayed audits increasingly seemed to be at odds with what we were actually hearing and seeing. The fact that the $2.1 billion, 1.9 billion euros, at first went missing and now appears to have never been there was always our belief that, in fact, this company probably was never profitable. And I would guess that the senior executives may need some questioning, shall we say, on that account. This is kind of an amazing story. This company had all kinds of signs reported by media going back a year or two now, with evidence presented, and yet people still gave the company the benefit of the doubt over and over and over again till they could hide it no longer with the delay of the Ernst & Young audit. It's really kind of an amazing case study, if you will. And I guess I have a feeling I'll be teaching it in my history of financial fraud class as one of my future cases. Let's put it that way.
Always new examples to add to that class curriculum. I wonder, though, whether Wirecard or any of the other companies that you're keeping an eye on here was using pro forma metrics, because I know that's something that you see as a common theme with a lot of companies that you're skeptical on, especially companies maybe from the Silicon Valley that have to do with the gig economy.
Right. So actually, Wirecard did not really abuse the pro forma metrics that we've talked about over the past couple of years. It just appears to be something much more basic than that. But having said that, I do think that one of the real abuses that's going on right now is the use by companies of their own devised metrics to tell investors, well, we're not really losing money. You see, if you add back all these expenses, we're actually profitable. And it's one thing to add back depreciation and amortization for some companies, although for most companies, that's a real expense as well. It's another thing to add back compensation, which a lot of tech companies do because they pay it in stock. And we could go right down the list. I mean, there's all kinds of things I suspect that'll be added to the add backs in this year in particular because of COVID. But increasingly companies are devising their own metrics. And I think it's one place where the regulators, could do a better job at forcing companies to really adhere to GAAP and not their own made up numbers.
Right. Well, some companies get stopped before they can actually come to market, like WeWork and the community adjusted EBITDA. Jim, I want to talk about one of your most famous calls, which is Tesla. You've been publicly short since fall of 2015. And the problems and problematic behavior of Elon Musk are well documented. But if you look at the stock, it's quadrupled since the past year and is now above $1,000. And it keeps trading like a growthy tech startup rather than a car manufacturer. First of all, are you still max short Tesla? And is there anything that would make you consider throwing the towel on this short?
We are still short Tesla. I think that you put your finger on it. I mean, the market is saying this is a tech company. I put out a spreadsheet every quarter comparing Tesla to all the other auto OEMs. And what's shocking is just how much it looks like another auto OEM. Almost the exact same margins, returns on capital. It's a tough business. Tesla's revenues have been roughly, will be roughly flat for the last six quarters. So even the growth story, I know people are counting on all kinds of growth going forward. But the fact of the matter is the company's rate of growth has slowed dramatically. And in North America, we think they peaked out in terms of auto shipments last year and are doing so in Europe this year. China's still the growth area for them. But look, I mean, this is a company trading now at almost a $200 billion total enterprise value. So it's trading at 8x revenues. Most of the other automakers trade between one quarter and one half of revenues. So this is really totally a perception by the market that there's some cutting edge technology here. The problem is that what everyone's excited about, whether it's batteries or autonomy, Tesla's not a market leader. Panasonic makes its batteries. The new super batteries out of China are made by a company called CATL. Audi in its A8 actually had level 3 autonomy while Tesla's still at level 2. And as everyone's seen the videos of Tesla still slamming into to parked or overturned semi trucks. I mean, it's quite something. So this company, I think, is a wonderful barometer of where people's views are on companies and speculation. Because mm-hmm. people see Tesla how they want to see it. And I think the product of Tesla that's always been first rate has been the narrative.
Okay, so to be clear, you don't necessarily see fraud going on here. There might be some accounting irregularities, perhaps, in the way that Tesla calculates things. I mean, that's something David Einhorn, another short seller, has pointed out. He talks about the accounts receivable at the end of the first quarter. But do you think there's fraud going on here at Tesla?
We have plenty of questions about the numbers. We have plenty of questions about management's veracity. All you need to do is go back to the SolarCity acquisition and see how they justified it and then what came out legally after that. I could go on and on and on. The offer, the bid. It's a company where we've seen a revolving door of executives. That's continued. Chief counsels come and go quickly. Let's just say I think that the accounting side of the story is important, mm-hmm. But the extreme, extreme valuation relative to the reality is just as important.
So if that's the case, Jim, why didn't the risk off in March do further damage to Tesla and other companies that you have a short thesis on? If the crash didn't take them out, what would take them out? I mean, what is it that's going to be the catalyst that leads to Elon Musk getting his comeuppance?
Well, I will remind you, Scarlett, the stock went from 960 to 360 during that period. The market did.
Okay, and you're still maximum short on it?
We're still short the stock, yes.
Okay, let's talk about electric truck maker Nikola. It listed this month, no revenue right now, and there are hopes that it will be like a Tesla disruptor in the future. In fact, the founder, Trevor Milton, often comes off like Elon Musk 2.0. Do you have a position, and if not, what would make you consider taking a position in it?
We don't have a position currently in Nikola, but I'm a little amused that it's taken this long. Given that Tesla's been so successful in selling a narrative, I'm actually shocked that it took this long for someone else to figure that out and come out and try to sell a narrative. So let's leave it at that.
All right. Well, the narrative is always key here. And another transport name that you are short on is Localiza. It's called the Hertz of Brazil, in essence.
Yeah.
You see a lot of parallels between Localiza and Hertz, especially from a couple of years ago. Explain your thesis here.
So we were short Hertz. We've been short Hertz for the last few years. We covered it right before the bankruptcy. I had publicly said I didn't think they were going to survive the next recession, and they didn't. But in doing our work and looking at rental car companies around the world, we were struck by one in particular that seems to be going down the same road that that Hertz went down, no pun intended, from a couple years ago. And what got Hertz in trouble a few years ago was, despite the fact of its meager to no profitability, it was expanding its balance sheet much faster than its revenues and cash flow. So every incremental car was actually, you know, bringing them less in terms of cash flow and profits. And ultimately, we figured that was going to catch up to them. Well, the largest, one of the largest rental car companies in Brazil, Localiza, is doing the same exact thing. It's basically growing its balance sheet and its capital multiples more than its revenue and cash flow. And it's borrowing to do it. And despite that, the company is trading at 40 times next year's earnings, 17 times EBITDA, which, you know anything about car rental companies, you'll know how absurd that is. But more importantly, its marginal return on capital is going through the floor. On top of that, a huge chunk of their rental car customers are Uber drivers, who are not exactly the greatest credits in the world, particularly in Brazil. And so of all of these things, you know, the car rental business is not a lot different around the globe. It's a pretty similar business model. And if you look at Localiza, you know, in their attempt to try to take market share, they're growing their balance sheet so fast relative to cash flow. We think that's going to be a problem down the road.
Let's go from Brazil to your favorite country, which is China. The debt keeps multiplying there. We know that U.S.-China relations are only worsening right now, no matter who enters or stays in the White House in November. You are short some large Chinese banks. Explain how this is going to play out when Beijing is going to be the backstop for its financial system in the same way that the Federal Reserve is the backstop for U.S. SIFIs.
So China is interesting. It's kind of come off the front financial pages, you know, with COVID and the trade war issues. And I heard Steve Schwarzman, you know, before discussing it as well. What's constant about China is the debt situation. It just keeps going up. And this has actually put a damper on Chinese equity returns over the past 10 years. I always point out, when we got bearish on China, the FXI, which is the large cap China ETF, was about $40. And I think it's right around there now. I mean, it's gone nowhere in 10 years. And I think that part of the problem is that in terms of the large cap Chinese companies, and I'm, you know, everybody knows a high tech company or two that has done well, but in terms of large state owned enterprises, they're just not very economic, and that goes for the banks. And so China is going to still have this debt situation it has to grapple with. Residential real estate is still a monstrous part of the economy, and basically it's the same old, same old. And the problem for investors is the same old keeps yielding very mundane returns to equity holders. It's just not been, in aggregate, a great place for Western investors to put their money. No return in the equity market over 10 years, is, as other markets have doubled and tripled, is kind of saying something. The other area we're concerned about is Macau. We think that, again, we think that the U.S. operators in Macau have an additional risk that's not being priced in, which is the fact that their concessions come up for negotiations next year, and they expire in mid-2022. And you look at a Wynn or a Las Vegas Sands, the majority of their cash flow at Wynn comes from the Macau concession. And if that were to be negotiated downwards, which is a real possibility, particularly if the trade wars continue, that would have a material effect on their cash flow and profits.
Yeah, we know things can turn on a dime when it comes to China and how policy is made. Kyle Bass, another noted China bear, is starting a new fund that will make all or nothing wagers on the Hong Kong dollar's peg. Do you see the Hong Kong dollar peg surviving the next couple of years?
I have no, we don't trade currencies. I'll defer that one to Kyle. He knows that world a lot better than I do.
All right. We talk a lot about your ability to spot financial fraud. I wonder if you can explain to me how you think companies are gaming the recovery, and especially the stimulus that we're getting, they're getting from the federal government, whether it's Congress, whether it's the Federal Reserve. I mean, in trying to figure out the next generation of corporate frauds, what are you looking for?
Yeah, I would suspect that there's probably, in light of the fact that the government announced it would crack down on usage of PPP,
Jim?
I think there's probably not a lot of that going on, and certainly not in public companies. In fact, the public companies that were going to get PPP were kind of shamed into, a lot of them, into declining it. So I'm not sure that the stimulus program is going to, in the public sector, is going to have a lot of instances of fraud. The question will be, obviously, how much of the stimulus is one time? Will it be renewed? But I think that strays away from the area of illegality. I think that's a policy issue. I think I've lost you, Scarlet, again. Oh.
Okay. Well, policy has made it so that companies are always, it feels like, able to raise more capital when they need it. And the government really doesn't allow the cycle to turn over. What proportion of questionable behavior, fraudulent behavior, can remain hidden when we're in an environment like this, where companies can always raise more cash? So whatever frailties in their model don't get exposed.
Yep.
It's a great question. And I'm giving a lecture tomorrow at our own Fraud Fest conference on the 300 years of financial market fraud and some recurring themes. And one of the themes of that is that the fraud cycle follows the business and financial cycle with a lag. So typically, as economic expansions go on and bull markets go on, people's sense of disbelief drops and they begin to believe things that are too good to be true. And as you point out, companies with questionable business models can get funded. Look at Wirecard, got funded last year by an affiliate of SoftBank, which is an irony in and of itself, by the way. But and so people, when they're making money hand over fist elsewhere, begin to question things that kind of don't make sense to other people a lot less. And it's not till the markets generally turn down that people get a lot more conservative with their money and begin to question business models that they heretofore had sort of embraced. And so that's why you often see the waves of fraud being exposed after the cycle turns. So the question is, people don't realize they're being defrauded until they want their money back. And so I think that wave of realization is still ahead of us, not behind us, the Wirecards and the Theranos is notwithstanding. The cycle going on and easy money will make it easier for companies that are not playing by the rules to keep the game going for a while. And that was the case, by the way, in the late 90s. I mean, the last really big wave of corporate fraud was post the dot-com era, with Enron and WorldCom and Tyco. and others, America Online. And so where we saw the revelations and the public's kind of disgust at the revelations after people started losing money, once the NASDAQ started heading down in March of 2000.
Jim, final question to you. We talk a lot about the stimulus and that how that forms a backdrop for the market environment right now. Do you think the Fed's stimulus picks winners and losers and promotes systemic inequality?
I think that the evidence is kind of, you know, pretty solid that disproportionate group of people, meaning wealthy people, are benefiting from the Fed's largesse. They own assets. I mean, it's not a surprise. And the people at the bottom of the economic ladder don't own a lot of financial assets. In fact, they're usually net debtors. And just one of the things I've commented on, and I'll leave it with this, is that I wish our central banks would pay as much attention to things like credit card rates as they do by maintaining asset prices. You know, if they really want to help people and they can't enact policy on themselves, they certainly could push the banks on consumer credit card rates and others, as opposed to propping up bank stocks. So that'll be my only comment on that.